We're going to go straight into God's Word. If you have your Bibles here, you can turn with me to Isaiah 62, and I'll be reading from verse 8 and 9. Isaiah 62, verse 8 and 9. If you dare, you can just say amen. It'll be also on the screen, so for all the people that are cheating, they can watch the screen. The Lord has sworn by His right hand and by His strong arm, I will never again give you grain as food for your enemies, nor will foreigners drink your new wine. Somebody say new wine. For which you have labored, but those who garner it will eat it and praise the Lord. And those who gather it will drink it in the courts of my sanctuary. Come on, that is an amazing word. Where God is saying, I will protect you. I will look after you. If you labor after me, this is what is going to happen. I will watch over you, and nobody will take away from you if I'm over you. And so this morning I was, you know, just praying and I was preparing for this. You know, this morning, and God just really spoke to me about understanding what it means, because we have to understand that we're in this process, in this season of new wine. But in order for new wine to come forth, there's a process, and I want to say yesterday, but last week I touched on it, about the, you know, trusting the process. And in a process of new wine, there's something called the crushing process that happens. Because if you understand the Hebrew, in Hebrew, the word translated for new wine means freshly pressed, squeezed, expelled, and trodden out. That's literally what new wine in Hebrew means. So it means it's been squeezed out. It's been crushed in order for those juices, the new wine, to come out. And we have to understand that that process, in order for new wine to come forth, it is inevitable that each and every one of us have to go through that process. And let me just say, even Jesus understood the process, because even Jesus had to go through the crushing process. You see, He humbled Himself in order to go through a crushing. The very thing that Paul says is in enmity against God, which is us, Jesus wrapped Himself up in it. It was a crushing experience because it meant that He would have to be hungry. And so after He fasted, guess what? God got hungry. Jesus got hungry. The Bible says Jesus hungered. But as God the Father, when He was in heaven, there was no question that He didn't have to worry about being hungry. There was no hunger. And now He knows what hungry is. And now He knows what tired is. Because guess what? The scripture says that when He was on a boat, what did He do? He slept. So Jesus in human flesh knew what it means to be tired. But when He was in heaven, He didn't have to worry about being tired. Whenever you get ready to pray, you can't bring up the feeling that He doesn't understand what you are going through. Because oftentimes, and maybe it's just me, sometimes I go like, but Jesus, you don't understand. The situation is so unbearable. I can't deal with this. You don't know, because you are just on your throne. You don't understand what's happening. And Jesus is like, I do actually understand. I've been there. I've done that. Got the T-shirt that says Messiah. He knows exactly what you're going through. He can be touched by the feelings of our infirmity, tempted in all points like we are, yet, and I say this, without sin. Trust His process, because Jesus trusted the process. Jesus trusted the crushing process, emptied Himself, even if it meant to the point of death. Philippians 2, verse 7 and 8 says, but emptied Himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. See, that was the crushing process for Jesus, meaning that when He takes on human form, He's going to have all these things that happens in life, He's going to have to deal with, even to the point of where He has to die on the cross. In order to go through a crushing, You have to humble yourself. You have to give up on some of your power and some of your will and some of your influence and some of your opinions. And you have to be quiet. I had to just scratch out that because I put there, you have to shut up. And I thought, let me be more graceful and just say, be quiet. And humble yourself. And you have to be still and know God is God. Just go with me on this quickly. Because as I was preparing for this in this week, it got to me to think about this. God is God. Okay, so let's start there. Let's get the foundation right. We all understand that God is God. And we all understand that God is omniscient, okay? Meaning that he knows all things, he understands all things, okay? So God understands that he's going to send his son, his only begotten son on earth. Are we still with this? So he does ministry. Great. Awesome. But then all of a sudden, he gets hung up on a cross. And he dies. And guess what happens? There's no tomb for Jesus. Are you still with me? Because they had to actually ask somebody, hey, can we borrow a tomb from you? Was it that it caught God by surprise? That it caught heaven by surprise that, ooh, we didn't get a funeral cover for Jesus. We have to read the fine print. They didn't cover the gravesite for Jesus. Can I be honest with you? It didn't catch them by surprise. It didn't caught them off guard. Can I tell you why I think this? I'm here to tell you, he just borrowed it because he knew he wasn't going to stay there for long. I'm here to tell you to look at the crushing process that you are in as if it's not your permanent residency. You may have to live there for a little while, but don't borrow it. Don't stay there. Just don't stay there. Buying something, let me just stay there. Buying something means it is yours. When you buy something, when you buy a house, your title deed is on there. It means it's yours. So when you buy the gravesite, it means it's yours. When you buy the sickness, it means it is yours. Don't buy depression. It is not yours. Just borrow it if you need to. Oh, I'm depressed. Borrow it. Don't stay there. Don't say, that is my title. That's not your title deeds. Borrow it if you need to, but get out of it. Don't buy the pain. If you need to have pain, borrow it. But don't buy pain. Don't buy loneliness. I'm so lonely. Don't buy loneliness. Borrow loneliness if you need to. But don't stay there. Yo. Don't buy suicide. Yo. Can I tell you, suicide has got not your name. It's not your title. God has given you life. So if you feel depressed, be there for a while, borrow it, but don't stay there. Move out. Rent it if you must, but don't own it, because by Sunday morning, you'll be out of it, just like Jesus out of that tomb. But we have to humble ourselves and surrender to him, our wine dresser. He is about God control, not self-control. Because you see, self-control does not take grapes and turn them into new wine. It is only through the control of God that takes water and turn them into wine. The vine dresser has to do that. And if you ever hope to be what God created you to be, you have to submit yourself into his hands and know that he knows exactly how to do things and how to use you and how to bring the best out of you. You see, crushing is needed for extraction. Crushing is needed for extraction. T.D. Jakes says this, you cannot have promise without process. Those that God is going to anoint the most, he always crushes the most severely. If you say, I'm anointed, Pastor. Your pastor, you know, I'm anointed, Pastor. Can I tell you what's going to happen? If you say you're anointed, then be ready for the crushing process. Because you cannot say, but Pastor, I've got the gift. I can go and evangelize. I can go reach nations. I can preach well. I can sing well. Guess what? What's going to happen? There's going to be a crushing process. Because what he anoints, he will crush also. Because he has to extract the best out of you. See, when God takes you through the crushing, he knows what will come forth. He knows the juice. He knows the new wine that will come out. He knows you better than you know yourself. And we know the scripture. Psalm 139 verse 1 and 4 says this. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. So that means that the winemaker, because if we're going to be speaking about new wine and getting the new wine from God, we have to address that God is the winemaker. You are not the winemaker. You are just a vessel for carrying the new wine. He is the winemaker. So he knows the process. He's been through the process. He knows what it takes to get new wine out of you. And further to this, we know that every process has a promise. 1 Peter 5:10 says this. And after you have suffered a while, the God of all grace, who has called you to this eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, and strengthen, and establish you. Yeah. So it means after a crushing process, there's a promise that he will restore, that he will confirm, that he will strengthen, and establish you. This is the beauty of being obedient to the crushing process. Then we get to the next point. So if you're taking notes down, this is the next point. It is not just about the quantity, it's about the quality. It's not just about the quantity, it's about the quality. Second Corinthians 4:17 says this. For our present sufferings are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. Crushing is the method that God uses for quality control. He has placed his very best in us. And our hardships refine that gift, that talent, that anointing in you. It is only a matter of time where you will be revealed to the world, a gift of highest quality, walking in your eternal weight of glory. Now, to bring this into context, I loved using illustrations. I remember when I was still working in the plumbing industry. For some of you, it might be still. And I was working in the plumbing industry, and I remember the company that I used to work, they actually wanted to get SABS approved. Now, for those who might not still trying to figure out, it stands for South African Bureau of Standards. And so we wanted to get the ISO, then you get the number, so it means that you are of the highest standard. And so in order for that to happen, you have to go through a process. And so for a few weeks, I used to go to the actual offices and the labs of SABS. That's there at Westridge Stadium, just next to DCC. And so I used to go there for a couple of weeks to their labs. And I went to see how they do the process. So they take a product, you know, like if a manufacturer has made a product, they take a product and they take it through the lab. And then there's this one machine that will take the product and it will pull on the product to see how far the product will stretch until it tears. And then they have the guy that's writing down the numbers. He's like, okay, so much weight. Okay, Google. And then they have another machine that takes the same product and it puts it down. And there's like this big weight that comes and it presses it until it like explodes, because they want to see how much weight that product can go through until it breaks. And so I was going through the process and seeing what they're doing, And I'm like, oh, that's great. Because you see, what the lab does is it takes all these numbers down. And then it says this product can take so much of pull, so much of pressure, so much of weight before it will actually malfunction, before it will break. And then they give the information back to the manufacturer before the manufacturer actually puts it out on the market. Because then what happens is SABS, they have this little stamp, says SABS. Then they put it on the product, and then they have the information for the manufacturer. So if anybody asks, how much weight can this product take? It says, this is how much this product can take. This is how much of stretching this product can take. The information is on the actual product. And the stamp is there to prove that it went through the process. Now, I hope some of you are getting where I'm going with this. Because just as much as the manufacturer gets the knowledge and understanding of how much pressure can take, we have a manufacturer that knows how much pressure and how much weight you can take. And he puts his stamp on you to say, you are mine. You belong to me. And I know how much pressure you can take before you break. I know how much you have to endure before you pull apart. And that stamp is on you because it shows the world who you belong to and that you went through the process. You went through the pressure. You went through the situation. His approval on you because you know that he is with you. And I love this because many of us can say this because we've been through the process and we don't always realize when we're in the process, the next thing. I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I could say that. I didn't know I could write that. I didn't know I could have that. I didn't know I could become that. I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I could withstand that. I didn't know I can endure that. I didn't know I can survive that. I didn't know I could kind of overcome that. I didn't know that I will be able to come through that. How amazing is this when you go through this process and the manufacturer understands the weight that you were created for, what loads you can stand, how fast you can move, how much you can accomplish. He designed you for the life he wants you to live. And when you surrender to him, he will show you how to be the best version of yourself. So strip yourself from all your pride and all your envy and all your competition and all you need to measure up to other people who you've never been designed to be. And just be you. Just do you. Now, the next point I want to bring out is crushing produces character. Crushing produces character. When you haven't gone through the crushing, your character hasn't been established. Now let me just say this, and I'm going to say this, and I'm sorry, I'm not going to apologize for this. I'm afraid of people who haven't not yet gone through a crushing process. I'm afraid of their friendship because they will run out on you when you're on your way to the wine press. They will be around you when the grapes are fruitful and plentiful. But when it comes to move into the season of producing new wine, they will turn and run. And Numbers 13 actually speaks about this. Let me explain this story. Let me give you a background of this story. Numbers 13 talks about when Moses was dealing with, you know, going into new territory, a new season that they're going into. Going into the land that is filled with milk and honey. And then he's like having to get an exploration team together to explore what the other side looks like. And he sends 12 spies. And out of the 12, there was two gentlemen there. Remember? Joshua and Caleb. But here's the interesting part that we sometimes miss in this story. Because Moses tells the spies before they go out, he tells the spies they need to explore and see the fruits. Because, and it says in Numbers 13, it was the season for the first ripe grapes. It was the season for the first ripe grapes. So he sends the 12 out. So they go see for themselves. They go explore for themselves. And they see the grapes. And they are so big. Go read it for yourself in Numbers 13. The grapes are so big. They actually have to take a pole. And two men have to carry the grapes. That's how heavy and fruitful the grapes are to produce new wine. But the moment they get back to Moses, they moan. Or, in our translation, they whine. Okay. Sorry for the pun. But they whine. Because they're like, yeah, look, we have grapes. The season for ripened grapes. But there's giants there. There's situations there. It's going to cause us to go through a crushing process, Moses, and we are not ready for that process. And Joshua and Caleb says, we are ready because I want to see new wine through these grapes. You see, here's where they separate those who embrace adversity from those who run from adversity. Whilst Caleb and Joshua saw the crushing as an opportunity for God's glory, the rest saw it only as a waste of ripened grapes. I'm convinced that God made me who I am through the crushing. Not from high places. Whenever I'm in a fight with the devil, I don't tell him about my accomplishments. Can I tell you? I don't tell him about my accomplishments. He already knows what my accomplishments are. That's why he's contending for my soul. Because he knows what I can do through the power of God. That's why he's fighting. He knows my accomplishments. But I have to remind him from where I came from. I have to remind him that there was a time that myself, Roxanne, didn't know how much food on the table we will have because we didn't have a lot of money. But God said, you will minister. God said, you will go out. God said, you will reach nations. But I don't have food on my table, Lord. But I knew he will take me through the crushing process in order to get new wine. There was a time where we had a car. And believe me, I said to the other couple the other time in our counseling, yo, we drove a Hyundai Getz. Yo, who knows a Hyundai Getz? Yo, that thing is like a mini. And there was a time that when we started church in the mall, and we had to take all the equipment in that little Getz. The boot, the back seat. I even had to squeeze my little bum just to get the extra speaker in. But we did it. Sacrifice. Then I had to go do school ministry. Remember the time? I had to go do school ministry in Peter Maritzburg. Drove all the way. And as soon as I got there, I phoned Roxanne. I was like, yo, something's wrong with this car. Then the clutch starts messing around. The car's overheating. Now I have to get back home. And it's an afternoon. And it's traffic. And I'm trying just to avoid not to stop. Because the moment I stop the car, it dies. And I'm like praying, Lord, I know it's midday traffic, and I know I'm in Peter Maritzburg. I need to get home. It's all the way in Toti. I don't know how I'm going to make this. So I drive another 5Ks, and then I stop. Drive another 5Ks, and I stop. And then I see the robots, and I see it's red, so I drive even slower because it's red right now. I'm trying to time it. So just like, and then I'm trying to tell the cars, move! This is no time for idling right now. My Getz is on a mode of its own right now. But we laugh, but can I tell you how stressful it was? And it's at that time and that journey that you're, you know, then I fight with God. Because like, God, but I'm doing this for you. I mean, just that same day, I had about, 60 kids. that came after the school ministry that says, I want to give my life to Jesus because my dad passed away, mom passed away, and I was so far from God, and I had to pray that they received Jesus. And I'm saying to Jesus, but there were 60 kids I brought to you, and I was still running with the skoro skoro. What's wrong with you? Yes, your pastor did fight with God. Because we all do it sometimes. We might not be honest right now, but we do. But I knew where I came from. And every time the devil wants to tell me something, I tell him, I knew where I came from, but I know where I'm going. Because right now, I might be driving a Honda, I guess. I got now a Honda Accent. And that one is not giving me any hassle. And it wasn't because Kali did anything. It's because I believe God. I trusted God, even in a crushing process. When everything that could possibly go wrong is going wrong. I still trusted God because He took me from where I was to where I am now. So whether you want to spend all your time struggling or not, you sooner or later are going to have to realize that we are helpless without God. We are as helpless as the clay is without the potter, as a grape is without the winemaker. We need Him in order to direct our steps. We trust the Master to bring out of us the best, the good wine, the new wine that is inside of us out. Oftentimes, and I believe me, I get it. When we're in the process of being crushed, we just want the process to end as quickly as possible. We look for ways how we can cut out some steps of this process. But the truth is, quality takes time. Quality takes time. The band can start making their way to the stage. We live in a society, believe me, we've seen it all over. And I even shared on Wednesday, and you have to understand that there's different ways of using the word instant. Because God can work in a season where He can instantly heal somebody, where He can instantly have breakthrough in somebody, but it's all in God's timing, not our timing. But we live in a society where everything is instant. Instant porridge. Instant noodles. I mean, you just take some food and you just chuck it in a microwave and nuke it, and then you have your Hulk Hogan, whatever food, you know. Incredible Hulk food. But everything that we see in society is just quickly, quickly, quickly. Instant, instant, instant. Can I tell you, God doesn't operate in that way. He's not instant noodles and instant porridge. He is God. And so let me just say this. You have not yet found your future husband or wife, and you've been praying, and you say, Lord, I've been single for so many months, even years. I'm waiting and I can't see anything happening. Don't get impatient. Don't give up. Remind yourself, quality takes time. If you haven't received your car yet, you've been praying for a car because you say, I need this car because I need to go to this interview. I need to go to this job. I need to make my way to this. I need to drop my kids off for school, and this is becoming problematic. Lord, you know my situation. Don't grow impatient. Don't give up. Quality takes time. If you've been praying for your house, you say, Lord, I understand that I need a place to stay. I need my family to grow. I need a place to call myself, but I don't have this. Don't grow impatient. Don't give up. Quality takes time. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, quality takes time. Yo, don't turn out to your spouse and look at them and say, oh, I can see. Yeah, there's a lot of time we have to take on this one. But the truth is, family, when we leave the process in God's hands, we can't rush it and try to skip steps and try to negate it on our own to try and say, Lord, but this is just taking too long. I'm too impatient. I just need to just do it on my own. I can't see you doing anything anymore, so I'm just going to try and do it myself. Just remind yourself, when you're in that process, just do me this one favor. Just remind yourself, quality takes time. Because if God is the winemaker, He wants to produce quality in you, and He wants the quality to come out of you, so that what you then bring forth and out of you is of good quality. Because that's how the world will see the difference between who you are and the world. Because those who go for instant will not have the same quality that you have. Because what God sees as quality, He will take His most time with. So don't rush God. Don't shortcut. Don't try and negate through it on your own. But trust the process in the crushing. Trust God that He knows what He's doing. He knows what He's about to produce in and through you. Because maybe this morning you are sitting here and you feel that you are being crushed. The weight of all that can go wrong is going wrong and is pressing from every side. And it would be so easy in this moment, in this time, to give up. And let me just be real. Nobody will even notice maybe that you gave up. Nobody will even care even if you gave up. But rest assured that God never crushes His own without a purpose of eventually blessing them. And your new life to come forth. New wine to come forth. He did it with His only Son, Jesus, and He will do it with you. A winemaker knows what you have inside of you, and more importantly, He knows how much of crushing you can endure. There's only one who can be the true sacrifice, but there are many who can, in response, be a living sacrifice. Are you ready to be the living sacrifice this morning, church?
Amen.
Are you ready to be the living sacrifice for new wine to burst forth, to come out, so that you can be marked by Him and Him alone for His stamp of approval to be on you, to say, I know my son and daughter. I know they've gone through the crushing, but I know they can do this. I know they can accomplish this because they didn't run when it got too hard. They keep on pursuing me. They had the faith and the hope and the belief to know that after this process, new wine is coming out. Not just a little bit, but in overflow. Why? Because this world needs new wine. And so I pray this morning for each and every one this morning. If you are going through the crushing, if you are heading your way to the wine press this morning, don't run away. Don't hold back. Just say, Lord, I'm coming. I'm here to be crushed. Why? Because you know what you have inside of you. You know what can be produced in you this morning. And let the new wine flow out this morning. And so this morning I ask you to stand. As a living sacrifice, it means that we surrender all to God. All to Him. And we trust Him in this process. So I want you to raise your hands to the heavens this morning. I don't know what is crushing you this morning. What is the crushing process for you this morning? What it's looking like for you this morning? Maybe it's a family situation. Maybe it's a financial situation. Maybe it's a work situation. Maybe it's depression, it's loneliness, it's bitterness, it's comparing yourself to other people and their life and their situation. What is crushing you this morning? See, I don't think it was by any accident that even Gideon was in the wine press crushing wheat. Because what he might be crushing, you know, flour and stuff like that for a meal, but it was also out of fear that caused him to be in the wine press. And for many of us, might be Maybe we are fearful of life. We're fearful of our future, fearful of what this year is going to look like at the end. Are we going to make it through the month? Are we going to make it through this year? But I just want to tell you, but God. But God. You might be in a lonely situation, a struggling situation, a depression situation, anxiety situation, a fearful situation, a no money situation, an unemployment situation, but I'm here to say to you, but God. God can turn things around.
That's right.
He can turn situations around. You just trust Him. You just trust His goodness, His process for you this morning. Just continue to have your hands raised to the heavens as a sign of surrender this morning. If you trust God this morning, raise your hands to the heavens this morning. If you trust His process this morning, keep your hands raised. Heavenly Father and Almighty God and King Lord, Lord, as many hands are raised, we thank You, Lord God, that You are God. And Lord, many of us are going to go through a crushing process, or many of us are in a crushing process, Lord God. And we thank You also for those who have already been through the crushing process, and they can say and they can testify, I've been there. But I pray for those who are heading their way. Pray for those who are in that situation right now, in the wine press. It feels so bad, Lord God. It feels so hard. It feels just, it's never going to end, Lord. But I pray this morning that we will not give up. Quality takes time, Lord God. And I thank You, Lord God, that You take time in each and every one of us, Lord God. As You mold us, as You shape us, as You press in each and every one to produce the new wine to come forth. As You extract, Lord God, and we thank You, Lord God, that You sustain us. You're our sustainer, You're our provider, You're our healer. And most importantly, Your Son Jesus is our Savior. And this morning we come before You, Lord God, in surrendered hearts, turn to You and You alone. Heal our broken hearts. Remove all fear. Remove all anger. Remove all anxiety and stress. Even for those who got suicidal thoughts, remove all of that. And may the peace of God be upon each and every person this morning. May their faith just be increased. Holy Spirit, will You just continue to bring newness into them? We worship You. In Jesus' mighty name.